home territory with an old friend.
Yes, Nicky, one of the best moments of the season for me so far has been to see my old buddy Steve Grogan regaining his job as the starting quarterback of the New England Patriots. And Steve's given us a unique opportunity today to look at this, the offensive game plan the Patriots will use against the Miami Dolphins this afternoon. Thanks for letting us in on your secret, Steve.
You're welcome, John. If it was anybody else, I probably wouldn't do this. But seeing as how we're such good friends, I'll give you a little insight to what we're trying to do.
Thank you. How is this playbook made up, Steve?
Well, John, we come up, the coaches come up on Tuesday and put together the runs and passes that we think will work against Miami. And then we diagram all the plays on how they should be run, how they should be blocked. And we study these during the week, practice them, and decide which ones we think will work and put them into our game calling situations.
Steve, you're now calling your own plays. How do you like doing that?
I enjoy it. It puts a lot more pressure on me because I have to study this playbook so much more. But I'm not acting as a robot on the field. I'm doing the things that I think will work and the things that I'm comfortable with, and I can get a feel from our offensive line and our receivers of what they think will work during the game. And the coaches prepare us well during the week, but once you're on the field, you need to react, and I think we can react as an offense more with me calling the plays.
Okay, let's take first down and second down. What are you be looking to do on first and second down?
Well, on first and second down, we're trying to establish the run and the shorter passing game. Miami plays a lot of zone defenses, which means you can't throw the ball deeply down the field very often. You have to take the underneath things to the backs, the short routes. You have to establish your running game, keep them off balance, be patient, take what they're giving you, and then sooner or later, hopefully, you can make the big play.
Can you show us one of these running plays that you're going to use on first and second?
Well, this is the toss play right here, toss 29, where we pull one of the guards. The back that doesn't get the ball has to block the linebacker here, and if we get that whole side caved down in by pitching the ball to the other back running around the outside, there could be a lot of yards there.
How about a short passing play on first and second down?
Well, all of our passes are designed with short people, medium people, and long people. Here's a play, for instance, we call it Red Right 66. Stanley Morgan will run a deep end, Tony Collins will run about a 6-yard end, and my job to do when I drop back is to see what their linebackers are doing. If their linebackers drop deep, I'm going to throw the ball to Tony Collins. If they come up to cover Tony, I'm going to throw it over the top of them to Stanley. From looking at the film, it looks like Tony Collins is going to get the ball more often than not than Stanley, just because, as I said before, they don't want to give up the big play.
Steve, what about a play on third and short yardage?
Well, on third down and short yardage, John, we have a running back named Mosi Tatupu who's real good at running up the middle. That's what we've done most of the year. We're going to bang him probably off our left side where John Hand and Brian Holloway blocked for him. They've both been Pro Bowl players. They're two of the best in the league. One little wrinkle we have up our sleeve this week is that we feel like the Miami secondary tries to help support the running game a lot. And in a third down and short or a fourth down in inches, when they feel like we're going to run the football, we're going to put one of our offensive tackles at halfback. We're going to hand the ball to Mosi. It's going to look just like the running play that Mosi usually carries in that situation. Mosi's going to pitch the ball back to me, and we've got a wide receiver in Greg Hawthorne that's going to block momentarily, break down the middle, and it's one of those calls that takes a lot of guts to call, but if we get the right situation, it really could be a big one.
Thanks, Steve. Very interesting. We'll look for those plays during the game. I hope your opposite number, Dan Marino, doesn't cause your defense too many problems.
Well, I hope what we do is good, John, and I have a lot of confidence in our defense. They're playing as well as any defense in the NFL right now, and I wouldn't be surprised if they just shut Dan Marino down to practically nothing today.
Thanks very much. Have a great game, buddy.
We'll see what we can do.
It's a cold, damp afternoon in Foxboro, Massachusetts, for the meeting between the New England Patriots and the Miami Dolphins. The Patriots, on the game's first drive, surrendered possession with a punt. So now the Dolphins have the ball with a first down and 10 at their 21-yard line. Our match commentators Bob Greasy and Jay Randall.
Dan Marino at quarterback. 59.8% completion rate. He brings them out. high formation from the 21-yard line. Play action. And the pass is complete to the near sideline to Clayton. Ronnie Lippitt, number 42, had the coverage, a 6-yard gain. Marino with Nathan, Bennett, Harris, Clayton, and Hardy. And at the moment, they have Jensen in there as a wide receiver. Green, Foster, Stevenson, Taves, and Lee.
And that's the key, Jay. The different offensive line. Ronnie Lee starting at right tackle. Cleveland Green moves over to left. Be interesting to see how those two tackles hold up today.
Johnson, 87, now at tight end. Lorenzo Hampton, 27, is in the backfield. Jensen comes in motion. They give it to Hampton. And Hampton cracks near a first down as he got it over the 30-yard line. Wrapped up by the linebacker Steve Nelson, number 57. Sims with Owens and Adams up front for the Patriots.
Sims is really playing a lot better this year.
Good linebacking here. Tippett outstanding with Nelson, McGrew, and Blackman. In the secondary, Lippitt, the talented Raymond Claiborne, Roland James, and Fred Marion. Third down and one coming for Miami. First quarter, no score. Foxboro, Massachusetts. Ron Davenport is in that backfield now, and the handoff goes to Davenport. And it looks like he's got the first down. Nelson was the man that wrapped him up, number 57, along with Kenneth Sims, 77, and Dennis Owens, 98. Marino going long downfield, and the catch is made by Mark Clayton. Clayton had a step on Ronnie Lippitt. First down at the 28-yard line, 39-yard pass play.
Coming into the ball game, as you look at the protection for Marino, first down, it's very, very good. Marino throws the ball, good coverage by Lippitt, stride for stride, but the ball is so well thrown, and Clayton has such a knack for getting open at the right time when the ball gets there. That is the first long pass that Marino and Clayton have teamed up for in quite some time.
Jensen is in there as a wide receiver. Both tight ends, Hardy 84 and Johnson 87, are there. First down, Miami. Jensen went in motion. Hand off to Hampton. Hampton still on his feet inside the 20-yard line. The strong safety, Roland James, number 38, to make the play. Pickup of about 9 or 10. Excellent effort here by Hampton.
It's going to be key to watch the number 60, Taves, pulling and trapping on the linebacker, Blackman. Hampton goes inside and then just runs through Julius Adams, 85's block. Good, tough running by the Dolphins, but it's going to be key today, Jay, for that offensive line to see how they can handle this defense for the Patriots.
First down for Miami. Jensen again in motion. The pitch back to Davenport. Davenport is down to the 7-yard line. Davenport cut down by Fred Marion, the free safety, number 31. A pickup of 11. Jensen went in motion, and he did some good blocking here.
Well, he's in there for some reason. It's because he's blocking right here. You see him blocking on Blackman, 55. Now, Jensen started the ball game, Jay, and when I saw that in there, I knew he was going to be in there trying to block on somebody because he's a big, strong guy, even though he's a former quarterback. His block was key to springing Davenport for that good run.
Jensen is out. Duriel Harris, 82, is in there. First and goal to go from about the 7-yard line. A quick toss and incomplete. Now here's the flag. The flag is thrown. Ronnie Lippitt was there against Mark Clayton.
Illegal, Chuck, number 42, first down.
Call against Ronnie Lippitt, an illegal chuck and a first down at the 4.
So it wasn't pass interference, it was a legal chuck 5 yards downfield from the line of scrimmage that was called on Lippitt.
The Dolphins have been passing more this season. In 84, on their way to the Super Bowl, they passed or attempted 55% of their plays. First half of this year, they've been up around 61%. Hardy going in motion, now sets to the left side on the wing. Handoff goes to Davenport. Touchdown, Miami. 4-yard touchdown for Davenport. His fifth touchdown of the season out of Louisville. Young man born in Bermuda.
Watch the block right here of Jeff Taze as he comes around and gets a block on Rembert, number 52, as Marino will hand off to Davenport. Gets through there, it's a nice hole. He actually misses the block, but there was enough of a hole there that Davenport could get up and score the touchdown.
The rookie, Fouad Reves, out of Tennessee, will attempt the point. Don Strock will hold. It's up and it's good. A very impressive drive by the Miami Dolphins. They lead 7-0.
Quarter now, and the Dolphins increase their lead as Fouad Reves kicks this 26-yard field goal. So the Patriots trail by 10 points, but it's their drive we join with 5 minutes remaining in the quarter.
First down for the Patriots, and the handoff going to Craig James. James is out to the 26-yard line, and Hugh Green, 55. Mike Charles, 71, stalled him at that point. Second down and three. Pitch to Craig James. Cuts it back. And is short of the first down as Jackie Shipp, the inside linebacker, number 50, number one draft choice out of Oklahoma, played it very well. We have 3:55 left to play. First half. Third down and one. Withers and Tatupo are in the backfield. That's Tatupo, and he's got the first down. That's Mark Brown, 51 on the tackle. A pickup of about 7.
Take a look at the left side of that line against 55 Green and Blackwood. Good blocking up front. Withers and Tatupo come in on short yardage situations. Raymond Berry gets those two big backs. Good blocking, tough runners in on short yardage.
Fryer and Morgan are both set to the right side at the bottom of the screen. Over the middle, incomplete for Tony Collins, and the pass a little high. It is misting here. Grogan having a tough start here today on a very cool, misty afternoon.
Stats aren't that good, but Grogan has always been a quarterback that didn't care about his stats. He'll throw some big plays, try long passes, and whether he's completing a high percentage or not, he can still come back and make the big play.
One of the things they say about him these days is he has a better touch than he used to have. Now in his 11th season. On second down, he's got a man, and it is tapped away at the last minute by number 47, Glenn Blackwood. Blackwood making a fine play in front of the tight end, Lynn Dawson. Blackwood, a very intelligent performer out of Texas. He held out, of course, during preseason drills.
He was one of the holdouts. Glenn, Bob Brzezinski also held out. That was, I think, part of their problem, Jay. They never had the entire defensive unit together. They've had injuries with Baumar, Charles Bowser, and McNeil has been hurt. And then the new additions, Jackie Shipp playing this year for the first time, and Hugh Green. All that transition and all those new personnel has to have an effect on your continuity on defense.
Miami in the prevent defense, and Grogan leads them out of the shotgun. Grogan throwing, got his man, first down. The pass is complete to Irving Fryer, 18 yards on the play. Paul Lankford, 44, made the tackle.
Here's Fryer right here, and Lankford is covering him. He's just going to go straight down and break to the outside, and the outside receiver will just clear it out. You'll see nobody else is in the area because it's man-to-man coverage. Nobody else around. Pushes off a little bit, breaks to the outside, and the ball is right on target.
Fryer's second catch of the day. The first one didn't count as it was called back. 18 yards for him. 2:50 to play in the first half. Play action by Grogan. And incomplete. Craig James had moved out of the backfield. Obviously not the primary receiver. And the pass underthrown for James. Clock stop. Ball at the 48-yard line of Miami. Second and 10. Handoff going to Collins. They gave it to him out of that I formation, and doing an excellent job was Kim Bocamper, number 58, a loss of about a yard on the play. 10-0 here. Third down and 11 for the Patriots. Over the middle. Made it in front of Paul Langford. 24-yard pickup, and Grogan and Fryer connect again.
Here's Fryer. He's going to go straight down the field and break to the inside, and this receiver will clear the safety out of the way for him. As you'll see, comes to the inside. A good throw by Grogan. The Patriots are on the move.
Grogan now is 6 out of 14 for 70 yards. First and 10 at the 24-yard line. Tony Collins. Collins gets to the 21-yard line. Pickup of 3. Doug Betters, number 75, on the tackle.
Hugh Green is going to be an impact player on that defense, Jay. There's no question. As soon as he learns the entire defense, he's going to be as devastating there as he was at Tampa.
Second down and about 6. A minute and 23 to go in this first half. Grogan using play action, lots of time, throws over the middle, incomplete. He was trying to go to Irving Fryer again. Fryer cutting back over the middle. Bud Brown, the free safety, 43, had the coverage. Clock stop with a minute and 15 to go. Both clubs have 3 timeouts remaining.
Here's Bud Brown right here. He's just going to drop straight back, and the receiver is going to come down and break to the inside. Grogan is hoping that the play action will fool Bud Brown. Brown blocks back straight up and then sees it coming all the way and then goes for the interception. Just doesn't come up with the football.
Irving Fryer, Stephen Starring, and Stanley Morgan are all in the lineup now as the Patriots are spread out all over the field. New England, 4 out of 7 on third down conversions, 3rd and 7. Grogan throwing and overthrowing Stanley Morgan. Looked like Morgan might have had a step on the play, but Grogan overthrew him. Judson and Brown had the coverage. Tony Franklin, the 7-year man from Texas A&M. Tony Eason, who's been injured, of course, but can do the holding, will do the holding. Franklin had a 50-yarder last Sunday against the wind. He is 11 of 14 in the field goal kicking department. 33 of 42 field goals as a Patriot. This is a 38-yarder. Franklin gets it on the way. Plenty of foot. It's good. Well, he continues to prove he's one of the very best in the business.
The cold, damp conditions worsened, making life increasingly difficult for both television technicians and players. On the last play of the quarter, the Dolphins kicked this field goal to re-establish a 10-point lead.
We start the fourth quarter in the mist here in Foxboro, and there's the way the scoring has gone. The only touchdown of the day, a 4-yard romp by Davenport in the first quarter for Miami.
You got to give credit to Chuck Studley. A lot of criticism the last couple of weeks going to Detroit and having Detroit score 31 points, Tampa Bay scoring 38. He has come up here and really shut down New England's offense.
Well, and Don Shula's stood very strongly by Studley with all of the personnel problems. Pass going out to Collins. Collins is over the 30, 35. Jackie Shipp knocked him out, a 21-yard gain.
Watch the offensive line. As he set up the screen, 73 now is Hanny. You see him go off to the right along with Collins, 33, who gets the ball. 75 is Morris. Good play now. Hog Hanna and Holloway, if they could run a little bit faster, he may have gained a little bit more yardage because they were blocking.
They went that away, didn't they? All right, first down. Longest gain on first down today for the Patriots right there. And this one over the middle complete to James. And James outside at the 45, the 40, down to the 37-yard line. And this crowd is fired up now. 22-yard gain on the play. Langford and Brown made the tackle.
You notice that when Grogan gets in trouble, he's going to his backs. Collins on a screen on first down. He looks deep and dumps it off at the right time. Gives Collins and James an opportunity to break a tackle. James says, I want the football more. I want to make some big plays, and he can do it.
A lot of time, 14 minutes to play. We're in the fourth quarter. Dolphins leading 13-3. Whistle as James got the ball. And a flag is down. Referee Fred Wyatt, ball start. It's against John Hanna, number 73. Hanna, who is now in his 13th year. Raymond Berry. Miami had the ball 11-43 in the third period, but only came up with 3 points. They lead it 13-3. First and 15, and a big hole opens up for James. And he gets about 7 or 8 yards as Paul Langford, number 44, the corner man, made the stop.
The left side is two Pro Bowlers, Holloway and Hanna. Both get good blocks, although Holloway had his arm out, his left arm out, hooking Bocamper a little bit. James saw the daylight to the outside and jumps to the outside, but those two Pro Bowlers on the left side, that's why you see a lot of running by New England to their left.
Wouldn't you run behind those people too?
I'd stay behind them as much as I could.
Second down and 7. Grogan down the far sideline, overthrows the intended receiver, Craig James. Bob Brodzinski, the veteran linebacker, was isolated out there one-on-one with him.
He was, and he had good coverage. And Steve, that look on Grogan's face, he says, hey, it was supposed to work. We had that planned all week. It worked well in practice, but you got to give the credit to the Dolphin defense. They're playing very well and covering. That was a fake reverse. A lot of things for the defense to look at, but still they kept their coverage.
Patriots looking for their fourth straight victory. If they get it, they're going to have to come from behind. 12:48 to play. Third down and 7 at the 34. Grogan rushed, gets it out there. It is complete. And it is Stephen Starring, but he's a little short of the first down. Starring hit by Don McNeil, the extra defensive back for the Dolphins. And let's see what they do here on fourth down. Says, let's go for it.
He's not being conservative now. As you see, Starring, the Dolphins had a blitz on. He read the blitz and ran a blitz adjustment route. You can't fault him for not going far enough on third down on that play, because he had to stop because the Dolphins were in his face.
All right, they had Withers on the field. Now he's come back out.
They'll take a timeout.
And they're going to take a timeout. Tatupu is also out there, and they're going to talk things over.
3 games ago against Buffalo, when Tony Eason, who was there in the red jacket, by the way, with the headset on, was injured, and Grogan had to come out and play. Grogan came out, and he fumbled the first snap. And talking with him, he said, I think my knees were shaking worse than they ever shook in my life, any time I've ever played professional football. They got a tackle in the backfield.
Fourth and 1, they've got a tackle in the backfield. And here is a trick play, and it is a touchdown to Greg Hawthorne. Oh, the play on fourth down. And they're going wild at Foxboro. Bob, what they did was put throw to Hawthorne. They also had Plunkett in there as that extra tight end.
Right here is 67 more. They're going to fake this play, and Hawthorne will come from this side and make the catch. You've got to be watching the Chicago Bears and Perry, William Perry. The Dolphins had to see it also and said they're going to use him to block, so they're going to run left. And they didn't. They pulled a play action pass. We've got a ball game.
Perfection on that last play. But it's now Miami's ball on their next drive.
11:14 to play here. Dolphins leading by 3. Second down Trouble. And Marino covers it.
You know, Jay, Dwight Stevenson is so quick, and whenever you have a nose tackle on you that is quick, sometimes you snap the ball and stand up too quickly, and that has happened twice already in the second half to Marino and Dwight Stevenson.
Third down and six. Marino over the middle. It is complete. Catch made by Clayton. First down at the 40-yard line. Rod McSwain, 23 on the tackle. They pick up nine. Clock running with 10:20 to play in this game.
Mark Clayton is just eating McSwain alive. He's catching deep passes. He's had interference. The bottom of your screen, watch him get to the inside of him. Fakes, then he goes inside, and you can complete this pass all day. It's a safe, easy, quick pass. You don't have to protect very long, and McSwain or somebody has got to be able to stop Mark Clayton.
The Patriots, you remember, took a timeout here in the second half. They have two remaining. And this one is almost intercepted, and there's a penalty marker thrown. Fred Marion almost picked it off. And let's see what the call is as they were trying to get it to Clayton again.
Illegal contact, number 42, first down.
Ronnie Lippitt, number 42, who played at Miami. They like to work on him.
Here we see it again, this time. There's a jam right there, past 5 yards. You can't touch him once they get past 5 yards downfield. That was not interference because the ball was not catchable, but early on, the official had to wait to throw the flag to see that it was going to be a pass, and that was the call.
55-yard line, 9:50 remaining in this game. Davenport trying to get outside, does. He's at the 50, bangs his way out of bounds at the 48-yard line. Fred Marion, number 31, making the tackle. The Patriots this afternoon have been penalized on 11 occasions. Second down and two. Jensen comes in motion. Nathan. First down at the 44-yard line. Steve Nelson, the tackle, the inside linebacker. Miami trying to hold on to this football, Bob, and eat up some clock and see if they can't get some points on the board as well. That's Nathan. Nathan to the 41-yard line, about three. Tackle made by Don Blackman, 55, and we have 8:50 remaining to be played, and the Dolphins have a 13-10 advantage. With the coverage,
and he had good coverage, but Clayton has got such great leaping ability that he can go up and take the ball away. Now Lippitt lets him get to the inside. The ball is going to be coming from the inside, and so it gives Clayton the first shot at it. He has got it and then drops it. There's a great angle coming right at you. The ball is caught and then slips out.
Jay,
the Dolphins can't complain about deep coverage today. They've had plenty of opportunities.
Marino throws, and it should have been intercepted. Ronnie Lippitt was there. Marino trying to get it to Vigorito. He obviously must have cut the wrong way. There was a miscommunication here someplace.
Let's take a look here. Vigorito's on the inside. He has to fight the jam. Now he's coming to the inside, and a miscommunication between Marino and Vigorito, and Lippitt should have had the play. There are drills the defensive backs do, and he should have had that. He could have possibly gone all the way for a touchdown.
Roby to do the punting. And it is into the end zone, just into the end zone. It'll come out to the 20-yard line. A 41-yard punt. We'll have more in a moment. Bob Greasy, you and I remember the snowplow game. We were here. I wonder where Mr. Henderson is these days.
You think they don't remember that in Miami, too? They do.
Oh, boy. Grogan on first down. A lot of time. Runs out of there at the 25, the 30, and he's got a first down. He paid for it. He picked up 12 yards. William Judson, number 49, on the tackle.
Steve's from the old school now. He hasn't learned to slide. He still dives in. Everybody's covered in the secondary. Good pass protection. There's a new rule in the league this year that if a quarterback goes downfield and slides, gives himself up, then he can't be hit. Steve's got to read the rule book. Be a lot safer.
7.5 to play. Miami leads 13-10. Pitch comes to Collins. Collins fights to the 36-yard line. Blackwood, number 47, and ship 50 on the stop. Second down and 6. And complete to Collins at midfield. First down, Jackie Shipp on the tackle. 14-yard pass play. Grogan has been a little high all day, but Collins making a very nice catch.
This is a missed the communication in the secondary. There's nobody around him. Ship to the inside is the closest one. Brzezinski comes in from the outside and misses another tackle. Good play by the Patriots, and Grogan has got him nibbling away, moving down the field.
Collins had 109 yards on 6 catches last Sunday. Now it's Weathers in there along with Tutupu. And James breaks through inside the 40-yard.
Offensive line firing out. Good running lane inside as both linebackers, Brown and Shipp, are blocked. Linebackers have to be more aggressive in meeting the guards as the play comes right at them, Jay.
Pickup of 12. Glenn Blackwood made the tackle. 5:25 to play. First down at the 36. Tony Collins. The 30, and another first down all the way to the 23-yard line. 15 yards on the play. Bud Brown ran him out, and this sellout crowd here in Foxboro is really rolling with this club as they march down the field.
Steve Grogan plays. He's mixing them up as Blackwood gets blocked, and Brzezinski is blocked to the inside by Ramsey. Bud Brown over to knock him out. But so many times, Jay, I've been involved in this series, and Grogan will not have had a good half. As I said in the first half, his completion percentage is not what is important. It's how he brings them back, and he's doing it right here.
On at the 23-yard line. Penalty markers are down. Greg James. James fights his way to the 13-yard line. Hugh Green, 55, on the tackle. Now a penalty marker goes down. There was some extracurricular activity at the 5-yard line. And we'll wait till they unravel this one.
Side defense, decline, first down.
98 yards for James today. He hasn't had a 100-yard game this season as Don Shula looks on. He had 98 against the Packers back in September, 96 yards on 15 carries last week. So it is first down at the 13-yard line. That's the first penalty for Miami. Back coming to James. Nothing there for him. Doug Betters doing the job. Big number 75. 99 yards on the day for James. Second down and 9. Greg James down to the 2. Or it was Tutupu. Wait a minute. Was it Tutupu? It was. Mosi Tutupu broke through. a big guy from USC.
Watch the linebacker right here as Hannah comes straight out and makes a block on him, and you'll see a gaping hole in the middle of the Dolphin defense. Right there, head on, Hog Hannah on the linebacker, and Tatupu runs right past him into the secondary, and you're in trouble when your safeties make the first contact.
Grogan asking for quiet. Withers and Tatupu.
Mosi
Tatupu comes up short. Near the 1 yard line. Brown and Ship and Betters are all there right there. Mosi's Moosis. Some of Tatupu's fans.
Mosi is a very popular player on this team with the fans. In fact, you saw his fan club. Very valuable player on the special teams. Some people think he should be playing a little bit more on the regular situation.
Patriots have done the job on the ground. 3:15 to play. Dolphins 13, Patriots 10. Second down, goal to go. Grogan rolling. Grogan, touchdown! Steve Grogan's got that football. 31st rushing touchdown of his career, and I think he's going to put that one on the mantle, Bob Greasy.
I think he will too, Jay, as we take a look at Don Shula distraught over. I'm sure they worked on this play. Grogan did it 2 weeks ago against the Jets. They knew he could run the ball, but you saw Brzezinski was back covering the receiver. As we get the completion of the extra point, if he would have come up to make the tackle on Grogan, he would have just dumped it over his head.
3 minutes, have the lead. Coming out at the 10.
Reverse.
And they give it off to Carter. Carter, and penalty marker goes down. Carter got it to the 22-yard line.
Illegal block in the back, number 53.
The call goes against Jay Brophy, the linebacker.
Steve Grogan on the sideline. He's reborn, you might say. Earlier in the season when Eason was going very poorly, he thought maybe that Barry would put him in the game. And he said, when he didn't put me in then, he said, I didn't think I would ever play this year. But he's the quarterback now, and he's doing a great job for him.
Dan Marino, can he make some magic? 2:53 remaining. Marino steps up and throws, and it is incomplete. The pass skidded into the hands of Mark Clayton. It was underthrown. Marino has been held touchdownless only three times during his short career. Versus New England, versus Houston and the Jets.
Once last year and twice this year. And how many times can you expect Dan Marino to bring you back?
Second and 10 from the 12-yard line. Over the middle, almost intercepted. Intended for Joe Rose, and Brett Marion almost had a touchdown there. If he could have held on, he could have just walked in.
Fred Marion right here as Rose comes across the field. Marino will not see him, and he'll step in front of it. And you're right, Jay, if he could have picked it off, it would have been 6 points. As you see Marion sneaking around, sees it coming. Good play by Marion.
And now third down and 10. And the Dolphins between a rock and a hard place. Long throw downfield, intercepted. Rod McSwain, now they say it's incomplete. But McSwain held to the ball, but he didn't. Trying to go to Clayton again.
pretty good coverage this time, but this is a frustration throw. Marino tries to get it in one more time. Clayton doing his very best. This time McSwain does the best job. That time he just dropped it.
Now Jim Bowman seemed to knock that ball away from him. He had it. Here's the punt. Fryer is downfield. Fair catch called for at the 36-yard line. So we've got 2:27 left to play. That was a 52-yard punt. The Dolphins are down 17-13.
You know, Jay, the play that turned this whole game around, the Dolphins were dominating, the crowd was dead, New England's offense was dead. Fourth and two on the Dolphin around the 30-yard line. They called timeout. Raymond Berry goes for a first down on fourth and two with a big play. And they said earlier in the season he was too conservative. That is what turned this ball game around.
That was the touchdown pass to Hawthorne. Here's James. James over 100 yards today. 18 carries now for about 108 yards. Rudzinski 59, Ship 50 on the tackle. And as we talked very early on, he wanted the football. The young man from SMU, he said, give me the football, we'll get it done.
A couple weeks ago, he went in and talked to Raymond Berry and says, I want to carry the ball 20 or 30 times a game. He's not getting the 30, but he's getting the ball running and receiving at least 20 times, and he's producing.
Second down and the long four. The Patriots leading 17-13. Was Craig James tacking on to his big total today as Ship made the tackle at the 45-yard line. The bunch in Foxboro. Patriots would like very much to get the first down and keep the ball here. Third down and one. And the pitch coming to James. And he doesn't get it. A big play over there by Mark Brown, number 51, the right inside linebacker. There's Marino talking things over with his head man. They still have a life, Bob.
They sure do, and what better man to try it than Dan Marino? And you know, he is really doing it with only half of his weapons. By that, I mean Mark Duper is not playing. Nat Moore, the fine wide receiver, the veteran who has come on and taken up a lot of slack for Duper, has been a role player when Duper was in there, is not playing. So Marino really only has Mark Clayton and Tony Nathan.
And he's had to go to Clayton when he's needed the big play, and that's no secret to the Patriots.
That's exactly right. But still, they've covered him pretty much the way they did with man-to-man coverage, one-on-one, haven't double-covered him a whole lot. But Marino has tried to go to him, but he needs to go to his tight ends, too. I think this next series, his tight ends may be open.
Rich Camarillo to punt to Vigorito. Return one for 23 yards. Oh, a high pass. He got it away. Wobbly kick. Vigorito lets it go. And Miami will have it at their own 18-yard line. And we have 1:42 remaining. A 31-yard punt by Camarillo. Ed Williams was downfield for the Patriots. Out on the field. Number 13. Danny Marino.
One timeout. Minute 42 seconds. Most NFL teams work on the two-minute drill two or three times a week. Marino has been very successful in the past, but again, how many times can you ask him to bring him back?
Very few people have left this stadium. They want to see this one to conclusion. Marino throwing and incomplete at the 33-yard line. Rod McSwain had the coverage against Mark Clayton.
Clayton had actually caught the pass, and McSwain knocked it out of his hands. As again, we see this same coverage, man-to-man coverage, with some help deep. Clayton jumps to get the football, and McSwain stays with it and knocks it loose.
McSwain has been around that ball today, the nickelback.
Yeah, certainly has. Good and bad.
Marino throwing, intercepted. It was Clayton who had it and lost. lost it. And coming up with it is Roland James. That ball, it popped out. There was Roland James. We've got a marvelous replay of this. Dick Klein and his crew, here it is.
Marino, with plenty of time to throw, steps up in the pocket. Now Clayton just comes back for the football. I think he juggles it. The ball is up in the air, and James, right there, close by, makes the interception. A big play for Roland James.
Three plays later, the game ended, and Steve Grogan left the field having staged that remarkable fourth-quarter comeback and led the Patriots to a 17-13 victory.
That was an incredible win. And Steve, you were the star of the show. Looks like the game plan we talked about went pretty well. You talked about giving the ball to the backs. How did you see it?
Well, we ran the ball real well today, and the toss play that I showed you this morning was one of the running plays that got us some big yardage, along with some of the other ones. We had our best rushing day of the year against Miami today.
Well, the big play of the game was definitely that 4th-and-1. Can you tell us how that worked?
Well, when I showed you that play this morning, I really wasn't sure whether we'd ever get it called. And we had a 4th down and less than a yard. We were down by, I think, 10 points at the time. And Coach Barry called the play and sent it in from the sidelines. I'm not sure I would have called it myself. It took a lot of guts to call it, but it worked. And it turned the momentum around and was probably the key play of the game.
What do you call that play?
We call that slant 135 flea flicker. It's called flea flicker because somewhere back in the annals of the NFL, anytime somebody hands off, pitches back, does something crazy with the ball, that's called a flea flicker.
Well, the Patriots are now 6-3. It's looking good at the middle of the season. Were you looking forward to a super end of the season?
Well, John, we've won 4 in a row. We're playing extremely good football. Our defense again today just did a tremendous job of shutting Dan Marino down, holding them. We can still get better offensively, but we're right in the position we need to be. We're a game, assuming that the Jets win today, a game behind the New York Jets. We still have to play them again. We have 7 games left, so I think we're sitting in real good shape. With a team that's on a roll right now, we have a lot of confidence, and I really think it's going to be a great year.
Thanks a lot, Steve. You did a great job with us and a great job in the game.
Well, thank you, John. I appreciate it.
Steve Grogan giving us a fascinating insight into the work of a quarterback. Quarter were of 80 yards each, and not only did they present the Patriots with their 4th win in a row, they also condemned the Dolphins to their 3rd defeat in 4. Well, while John and Steve were talking after the game, the leaders of the AFC East, the New York Jets, were in action at Indianapolis, and the Jets maintained a 1-game lead over the Patriots with an astonishing first half display. Indianapolis Colts 17. The Jets 35 points, 5 touchdowns, all came before halftime. Quarterback Ken O'Brien threw for 3 scores, and Freeman McNeil rushed for 149 yards on 26 carries, his 5th 100-yard game of the year. Cincinnati Bengals 23, Buffalo Bills 17. Top-rated quarterback in the AFC is the Bengals' Boomer Esiason, and against the Bills, he was on the money again with 2 scoring passes and 193 yards. 130 rushing yards from Larry Kinnebrew came in handy as well for the Bengals. Cleveland Browns 9, Pittsburgh Steelers 10. The Three Rivers Stadium was more like the Four Rivers Stadium on Pittsburgh's wettest day in years. Browns had never won at Three Rivers, and at the 16th time of asking, they were beaten again by Gary Anderson's field goal, 10 seconds from the end. City Chiefs 20, Houston Oilers 23. The Oilers' offense, until recently the worst in the NFL, dumbfounded its critics again with three quarters of top-class, high-speed action. The Oilers saw a 14-point lead disappear in the fourth quarter, but they held off the Chiefs with a late field goal. Denver Broncos 10, San Diego Chargers 30. This was the key play of the game. The Broncos down 17-3, but close to the Chargers' end zone. Then Gerald Wilhite fumbled, and the loose ball went to the Chargers. The rest they left to Dan Fouts, 302 yards and two touchdowns. Los Angeles Raiders 3, Seattle Seahawks 33. The Kingdome in Seattle continues to be a graveyard for the Raiders. As usual, they ran into the Seahawks at their very best. Dave Craig to Kurt Warner. And Dave Craig to Darryl Turner, fire Lester Hayes. Chicago Bears 16, Green Bay Packers 10. For my next trick, the refrigerator will catch a touchdown pass. But while the headlines go to William Perry, Walter Payton keeps on running, 192 yards against the Packers. Detroit Lions 13, Minnesota Vikings 16, the last kick of the game. And the winning kick by Jan Stenerud of the Vikings. Tampa Bay Buccaneers 20, New York Giants 22. The Buccaneers were in front early on, but for the fifth time this season, they surrendered a halftime lead, and their tale of woe now reads, played 9, lost 9. Dallas Cowboys 10, St. Louis Cardinals 21. The Cardinals snapped a four-game losing streak with three second-half touchdowns, but did actually spike the ball before he reached the end zone for their first score. He was given the benefit of the doubt. Washington Redskins 44, Atlanta Falcons 10. Even without the injured John Riggins, the Redskins piled up 307 rushing yards, 164 of them going to second-string running back Keith Griffin. Philadelphia Eagles 13, San Francisco 49ers 24. Rested his bruised shoulder, and Matt Kavanagh made the most of his second start in 3 years, but the 49ers had to wait a long time before they could relax. Carlton Williamson's late interception finally snuffing out the Eagles. New Orleans Saints 10, Los Angeles Rams 28. Good news for Rams fans, Eric Dickerson is back in form. His first 100-yard game in 6 weeks included this 11-yard touchdown, and with quarterback Dieter Brock throwing for two scores, the Rams returned to winning ways with no trouble at all. That's the action from Week 9 in the NFL. So the Rams continue to lead San Francisco by three in the NFC West, but they'll be without quarterback Dieter Brock at the New York Giants this week. He had a kidney stone removed on Monday. Joe Montana will play for the 49ers at Denver. Chicago remain untroubled in the NFC Central, especially as the three teams below them keep cancelling each other out. This week, Chicago are at home to Detroit, while Green Bay are at Minnesota. The key game coming up in the NFC East is Dallas at Washington. The Giants are at home to the LA Rams, and the division could become even tighter if Philadelphia and St. Louis beat Atlanta and Tampa Bay as expected. And here's confirmation of the New York Jets' one-game lead over the New England Patriots. The Jets will be a big step closer to the playoffs if they win in Miami this week. New England entertain Indianapolis. Are these four tied for first place or last place in the AFC Central? Whatever, Houston are the form team with three successive wins, which should become four at Buffalo this week. Cleveland are at Cincinnati, Pittsburgh at Kansas City. Denver and the Raiders still lead the AFC West, but only just, and their next games are tough ones. Denver at home to San Francisco, the Raiders at San Diego. Seattle visit New Orleans.
So, and by my reckoning, 22 of the 28 teams are still in with a realistic chance of making the playoffs, and only 10 will get there in the end. Will the New England Patriots be one of them? John Smith will be mightily relieved if they are. In fact, he was telling me this week that the longer the Dolphins game went on, the more convinced he became that he'd put a jinx on his old pal Steve Grogan. But Grogan came through in the end, just as he said he would. I'll see you here next Sunday at 6. Until then, good night.